Hello, greetings to everyone. Namaste. Welcome to BTU eShikshana program. I am Dr. Dakshayani R. Patil, Associate Professor at BMS College of Architecture, Bull Temple Road, Bangalore. Welcome all of you once again. This is the course Building Services 3, dealing with air conditioning, mechanical transportation, and fire protection, 18 ARC 6-3 for the BIARC 6th semester. And I will be dealing with the modules 1 and 2, dealing with mechanical ventilation, air conditioning systems. So module 1 is complete. We are resuming the module 2, section number 3, where we are doing different types of AC systems currently. In the last lecture, number 5, we have seen what was it? Package AC systems. Right, so we are proceeding with two other types in this particular lecture, rooftop AC systems and VRF AC systems. Okay, so under the rooftop units and VRF systems, we will be checking out the components of the systems, the working principle for the same, advantages, disadvantages, and applications. So we will try to see how these systems are in place and in what way we can make use of them in our buildings as per the requirement, spatial requirement, and building requirements. So we'll begin with a rooftop, that is, which is designed to be located outdoors. So this is not an indoor component, but a rooftop unit catering to the indoors via the ducts. So generally it is installed on roofs, the open terrace areas, hence it is called as rooftop unit. All of the refrigeration, cooling, and air handling equipment, they come embedded in a section assembled together. All right. So we get the various components or parts for the refrigeration, that is evaporator, compressor, condenser, throttling device, the various pipes, ducts, electrical cables, etc. And the heating coil, cooling coil required to undertake these two actions in a building. And the air handling equipment, with the filters, with the grill, with the supply return grills, etc. They all come assembled. We get all of these separately and assemble them together as a unit called as the rooftop unit. The compressor and condenser may be remote. These are the working components and the ones which are doing the hot air cycle. They undergo a lot of noise, vibration, and hence they can be placed remotely. Heating equipment may also be incorporated in the unit. So air conditioning essentially not only refers to cooling or cleaning, but during winter times or extreme climates, heating also is one of the requirements or objectives of AC. So there are various manufacturers or providers, service providers, I would say. One example of a rooftop unit, which looks something like this, a rectangular big mass, elongated, and has to be placed on a sturdy base on the terrace. It will have all the components embedded, doors for maintenance, etc. In this case, if you see the specification, it is meant to be heating and cooling provider 15, and they come in ranges from 15 to 140 tons. So likewise, the mass of the unit also varies. And the refrigerant that is used is R410A, which is supposed to be one of the green refrigerants, that is harmless to the ozone layer. The section on refrigerants, we have seen the negative impacts of using the fluorocarbon elements and how there are innovations going on for better alternatives, safer alternatives, keeping our environment in mind. So one of the graphical representations of the components, broadly speaking, in the rooftop unit. So we will have the return air to the bottom. If you can see my cursor, please. The return air entering the system. So what is return air? It is the used air from the indoors. The air that is hot, the air that has to be cleaned, cooled, dehumidified. So return air, because it's returning from the room. Then the one where you give in the cool air is called as a supply air. You're supplying the room with clean cool air. So you have the return air entering, and then you have the influx of the outdoor air, both mixed together. Because outdoor air is essential to exhaust, to remove the exhaust or dilute the used air. And then it passes through filters, then the cooling coil. Can you tell me what the cooling coil is also called as? What is the synonymous name for cooling coil? Right, evaporator. So evaporator or cooling coil. And a filter before that, then it enters, then you see the supply air that is being given back, because the air has got cooled now, cleaned, so dehumidified. So supply air fan is going to thrust the clean cool air into the space. So that is a green arrow. Then what is the working part to the to this AHU? We have the compressor in one of the sections. The condenser in the last section. Condenser is that heat exchange in the system. So to cool the condenser, in this case, what do we have? Is it an air-cooled condenser or water-cooled condenser? It can be used as dual purpose. So it has the air coming in to cool. It's a air-water system. And there is water cooling, water supply also. So we can toggle between water cooling and air cooling in this particular given example. Then the and the top fans are required when we are adopting the air as the fluid medium to cool the condenser. All right, so condenser air cool. So this is how a system is in place, and the vapor refrigeration cycle is the base fundamental principle on which it works, because you're seeing the expansion, compression, condensation, etc., and the components are sequentially placed. So that is how a unit is packaged. All these evaporator coil, condenser, compressor, fans are embedded in this particular big package and placed on the rooftop. And on site, there has to be provision made for the electrical wiring, the refrigerant piping, the influx of the outdoor air, and ducts to get in the return air and give back the supply air. So all that involves a labor skill on the site. Oh, one more example. This is from Daikin, and that is the link catalog from Daikin AC providers, package AC. So wonderfully depicted, a sketch, a schematic view of the components. We have the return or exhaust fans. So return refers to exhausting of the used air, right? So we have that here. Then number two, factory mounted variable frequency drives. So we can toggle between different fan motor speed according to the velocity of air required, hence it's called variable. Also, it will control the sound levels in the cycle. We have airfoil fans, the ones running there, economizer. So these are the product specific ingredients that the manufacturer of the package rooftop unit is providing. So they have lot of these innovative R&D happening in each of these companies, and they come out with value adding elements to the existing systems. Then we have the hinged access door. Of course, you need to have a door because now there is good amount of maintenance required, oiling, cleaning, fabrication as and when required. So that is the one part of the rooftop package unit. Let us see the next, the other half of it. So the other half of it is the it shows just a section to the other side. So we have all these happening. Control system, because the engineer will modulate the system for the required parameters of the requirement, fan motor, then velocities, etc. Remote user interface option provides all functionality of unit mounted interface. So the remote access also is possible. This is another product, dual two-way valve refrigeration schematic. So it talks about how the mixed air at what temperature and mixing with the return air, then the cooled air which is coming out. So it was at 80 degrees, right? Driver temperature coming out as 55 degree driver temperature. It's an amazing drop. Condenser coil. Then you have various pipes which include the reheat coil. We did this sequence and components in the first lecture of module 2, introduction to the AC, where we spoke about what is a reheat coil, control valves, reheated air, and there are ways to reutilize the heat that is generated from here in a heating tower. So wonderful schematic which gives an idea, an idea of what the system is encompassed with. So when you see the cooling coil to the left, right, you have the filter just before the cooling coil. So it is going to pass through screens, get clean, and then enter there. So the red mixed air is turning to cold air. We can even draw a sectional elevation of the same and label the parts. As long as you understand, one, what are the components? Second, what is the sequence in which they are arranged, and label them. So, exhaust dampers, exhausted air, influx of outside air, return air, outside air, mixing in this chamber here, and then passing through louvers, evaporative coils. After the evaporative coils, then there is a supplier coming back, etc. So rooftop units may be used with ductwork and air outlets. So ductwork to transport the air from one point to another. They must have weatherproofing features. Now this is a prerogative, right? Because we are placing it on rooftop, it's an exposed equipment on the terrace. So weatherproofing features is a must from the weather elements, rain, harsh sun, wind, and such stuff, thunder, lightning. All electrical parts must be moisture proof to avoid any possible mishap in the system functioning. Casing and other exposed parts must be corrosion protected. in response to the rain and the humidity that it is exposed to being outdoor. So what do we see the as advantages in a rooftop unit? We have to visualize actually we because when we do choices of a suitable AC in our projects as architects, we need to be aware of what system suits where and what to propose to a particular project or a client. So rooftop unit do not use the valuable building space, right? So it is not occupying any indoor space per se. So no demand on space indoors. It's a good point. Every inch is valuable and it helps. Relatively low cost compared to central air conditioning. Units are available with multi-zone arrangement. So multi-zone is when the building is divided into different zones. A zone is a particular space or group of rooms and spaces which has a similar demand of air conditioning. So depending on the heat generated there. So we pool them as a zone. So different zones might be identified or planned based on the load requirement. This helps in efficient planning and better energy conservation. So what happens with rooftop, it will enable this kind of multi-zone arrangement possible. So you can have zone A, B, C with XYZ load requirement for the AC. It's a good way of approaching a conceptual design of the HVAC system. Hence, it offers zone controls. So each zone can be centrally calibrated and monitored. It is a good way of controlling the zones. Both humidity control, but humidity control is limited. So its hold on aspects like dehumidification is on the lower side apparently. It is one of the extremely popular choices. Could you guess why so? Yes, because of the previous few points that we discussed, and also because it helps these commercial buildings in occupying the terrace and not their valuable space inside. Cost effective, multi-zone availability, one of the advantages. In low cost one-story building applications also it is effective because of the range that we saw the product provides. Helpful in supermarkets, suburban commercial buildings which have lack of space or which would want to go in for cost effective energy efficient systems. Now moving on to the next type, which we will see briefly, variable refrigerant flow, VRF system, short form, popularly VRF mentioned in most of the instances. So it was pioneered in Japan by Daikin in early 1980s, so 33 decades of good innovation and quite popular also. It caught up very quick. Recently it has gained popularity in the US also. So this is one of the things which was non-US based innovations, but then good things catch up. These systems have continued to advance over the years since their inception. Also the VRF system started by Daikin but has been notably adopted or floated in market by LG, Mitsubishi, Trane. You can visit these manufacturers' website, catalogs and see the specifications. The term variable refrigerant flow, VRF, refers to the ability of the system to control the amount of refrigerant flowing to each of the evaporators, enabling the use of many evaporators of different capacities and configurations, individualized comfort control, simultaneous heating and cooling in different zones, and heat recovery from one zone to another. So this is defined by ASHRAE, and these are the various components or salient aspects of a VRF system. The first point is controls the amount of refrigerant. That's why variable refrigerant flow. So when you vary that, you can toggle or control the capacity output also. So each of the evaporators, so this refers that the indoor units, the terminal units where the supply air is coming out, hence we call it the evaporator end. So we can use many indoor units with one single outdoor unit. Not only that, you can vary the capacity or output of each of the terminal devices or the evaporators. You can possibly have individualized comfort control, which is essential because every human has different comfort ranges. Someone comfortable at 16 degree wouldn't be comfortable even at 21 degree. So that individualized comfort controls are essential in certain zones at least, so that's possible to happen. And you can avail both heating and cooling in different zones during winter and summer seasons. There is also possibility of tapping the heat recovery from one zone to another. So one of the service providers and their floated HVAC piping diagram, simple one. You have the outdoor unit which has the condenser, the blue lines referring to the liquid pipe, red line gas pipe, then they branch out as multiflex pipes, controls. So the point to note is five indoor units on the left side and three to the right. Indoor unit synonymous with evaporator or cooling coil, that is the interface between the room and the unit. And it also has possibility of future expansion if at all required. So that's the beauty of a VRF system. See, I'm indicating how the compressor condenser one unit can be connected to different types of terminal units. See here to the right side, you can vary whatever system you are using. The top one is a ceiling console, ceiling cassette type, you see, right? Top one, which flushes with the false ceiling. False ceiling, I'll show you here if you can see. I hope I'm visible again. Cassette type. Then you have the wall hung and those different types, right? So that's how a VRF system enables using different types of terminal units or the evaporative coils. And it adopts, it is based on a direct expansion multi-split system with variable speed compressor, and it is capable of delivering capacities according to the variable load requirement. So variable refers to different load requirements as per the zoning in the building. Different zones have different load requirements. They are based on the cardinal directions, north, south, west, east, and other factors such as shading, the activity within the space adding to more heat loads, etc. So this enables using a multi-split system. Operates at variable speeds to enable the variable load requirements. Delivers required capacity with energy savings at partial load conditions. So it also modulates the energy consumption when the load requirements vary or the system is working at partial load as well, which is a very crucial thing, because when the system is not working or halfway through its use or working on half the required partial load at a given time, the system should be able to adapt and use the energy relatively. So as this is enabled, it becomes an energy efficient system. The applications of VRF system, wide range of applications. It can be used in residential land building uses, apartments, villas, small and big. Can be used in commercial establishments like offices, clubs, restaurants, showrooms, departmental store. Also in healthcare facilities, hospitals, clinics, etc. Hospitality sectors, hotels, cultural facilities where events are happening, educational facilities and industrial facility. So we see that the applications are wide ranged and suitably because of its variable adaptations. So VRF system advantage, the first one that we recap, each outdoor unit connected to multiple number of indoor units via the refrigerant piping. So lots of terminal units of various typologies can be adopted. Cassette type, wall hung type, package type, and so forth. Reduces the energy costs because it can adapt to different scales of demand and air velocities. Improves occupant comfort because you are able to use the system as per the requirement of the space. Reduces the mechanical unit noise as it is away from the system. In terms of scalability, scaling, there is possibility of future expansion also. Variable capacity, distributed temperature control, and standard cooling or heating mode, different applications are possible. You can refer NBC Volume 2 for added information on VRF systems and the possibilities. Also, visit the various manufacturer website catalogs to know the system requirement and specification. Coming to the disadvantages or limitations of the system, dedicated outside air is required, is a must. The VRF indoor equipment is small or modular and not designed to process large amounts of outside air that might be required in densely occupied buildings. So in terms of its quantum or application for heavily occupied buildings, it has a certain limitations owing to the limitation of the terminal unit, which cannot process heavy outside air across the system. The initial costs, so the first costs are higher when compared to other systems. That is the capital cost in the investment of investment and installation of the equipment. But the savings in energy post the usage or during the life cycle typically returns the initial investment within 5 years or less. So it's all right. Sometimes the capital investment is more, but the life cycle costs are limiting and taking care of the additional expenditures that were incurred during the installation. So initial costs high and requirement of dedicated outside air supply, two things, and the constrained capacities of the modular terminal units or the indoor units is another limited scope of the system. So let us undertake an exercise to sum up this module on unitary AC systems and types that we have seen. Explore the evaporative cooling, direct or indirect cooling systems. You may refer NBC 2016 volume 2 also to undertake this particular exercise. So till now we have completed understanding air conditioning systems, introduced to the basics, basic components, principles, working advantages, disadvantages, specifications of each unit, and we saw I think four types of unitary systems: window AC, split AC, package AC, rooftop, and VRF. Five types we have seen under this particular section. So we will proceed to the central air conditioning systems in the upcoming lecture number 7. So thank you for being here, and let us meet on the lecture number 7 ahead. See you until then.